Hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Uncultured. Back this week for episode 2. Really do appreciate it. Thank you so much for joining us here today. On the show, we're talking about some very interesting topics, including but not limited to 10 big takeaways, everything you need to know about Drake with the release of his new project or his new mini project, Scary Hours 2, and a fun little piece in XXL about times rappers have really manifested something on Twitter or in an interview and how it really has come true. Also go through kind of the Song of the Week segment and some other stuff as well here on the show today. Thank you for joining us. It's an all-new episode of Uncultured. Yeah, so Scary Hours 2. Definitely some interesting stuff here, as Certified Lover Boy still hasn't arrived yet, but Drake just dropped an EP to hold us over 3 years after he released Scary Hours, featuring God's Plan and Diplomatic Immunity. One of those, again, ended up being a massive hit, and it's been 3 years since then. Wow. Like, it really is just like, you can kind of almost in a weird way kind of like do touchstone, like, out of certain memories or certain, like, feelings in your life when various Drake, at least in my position, like, the way it was when, like, Drake albums were released. But, like, if you would ask me when God's Plan was released, I'd say maybe a year and a half ago. Like, definitely not 3 years ago. It really does show you how long things have come. But there has now been a follow-up with the new tracks on Scary Hours 2 that we know so much about. And, of course, that's led off by Wants and Needs. What's Next, which is kind of probably going to be the headliner song on that one. It's going to be the one that you're going to hear on the radio. It's going to be the one that's going to be dominating the charts for a long time. It's probably the one that he set up to kind of be his biggest hit. And we're getting a lot of these kind of holdover projects, by the way. We're getting Care Package to hold us over, Dark Lane demo tapes to hold us over. Hold up. Like, is our appetite going to be so full that we won't even enjoy the new album? I don't even know. We will see. But I think it's very interesting because we have a situation. We have What's Next, Wants and Needs, Lemon Pepper Freestyle here. What's Next is definitely going to be the big hit. Wants and Needs, a solid, solid supplemental song with Lil Baby there. And the Lemon Pepper Freestyle is the kind of Drake that we all know and love. It's kind of the chill, relaxed, introspective, contemplative kind of guy who's very, tries to, like, you know, chill everything out. And just be very much kind of like the kind of late night Drake, I guess you could call it. So very similar to the Gold Roses collaboration. That's what a Lemon Pepper Freestyle reminded me of. This kind of the same vibe, really, as the Gold Roses collaboration. So yeah, and then Wants and Needs by Lil Baby. We can get a little bit. We can just get a little taste of that. You know what? I'm gonna get back on. We could play a short clip of Wants and Needs. How about that? Petty is real. Might charge my ex for a feature. Deposit the money to Brenda Leticia, Alinda Felicia. She came for me twice. I didn't even know for her once. You know I'm a pleaser. 42 millimeter was made in Geneva. That's a little bit of the Drake verse there. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's kind of very similar, like, it's kind of similar stuff to what we, like, kind of expect from Drake. As I can see, I have it up here on my Spotify, I have the album up, and you can see, like, the friend activity. I can see someone listening to Scary Hours 2 on my track list right now. We can see, like, where your friends are listening to. I can see someone is listening to What's Next by Drake, and that just shows you, like, this is the kind of music, it's very solid B-plus music. It's exciting, because it's head boppable, you know, you can kind of get into a little bit. But it's nothing too crazy. It's not anything that you're going to have on repeat over and over again because the song is just so infectious. No, it's appealable. It's workable. It's a good piece of music that you can certainly get the feel of and get a kind of good sense of and really kind of come to like. But, you know, you're not going to have it on. Like, this is not going to be the one you download and is going to be, you know, top in any person's, like, Spotify raps. You know, like, I don't think that, Yeah, it's like the common thing about Drake, the very, very common thing about Drake, at least for me, is that he casts his net as wide as he possibly can, and that is to kind of hit as many people with his music, kind of just get them to say, you know what, I'll put that on one of my playlists. I'll put it like, it'll be in my rotation, but it won't be one of my top songs. And I think he's real, like, that is the genius of Drake. So on Thursday night, Drake gave an update on the status of the album. He says CLB has currently been chefed in every way possible. You know, all the cringy things that you hear kids say, like, they're almost directly traceable from Drake at this point. It's kind of funny. Me and Noel have been grinding for a long time. I'm back in the studio with 40. I'm just really excited to see it. Really excited about the music we've been making. I feel like I've been locked in a zone where I'm really trying to execute on a project that's fulfilling for my soul. You know, I've been doing this for a set of years now, and it's a blessing to still be going, but I'm excited for what the future holds. I don't have an exact date, but I know it's in the pot. It's coming soon. Definitely excited to get the ball rolling tonight. So now that the ball is rolling, let's get into it. What did Drake deliver? What do these songs tell us about his mindset before CLB? What are the best moments? And we can definitely look at some of this stuff here. So here's a key point. Drake is in rap mode. You never know which direction Drake is about to go when he drops new music. Will he get in his R&B bag? Will he make a song that's going to end up all over pop radio? Or will he dig a beat from 40 and rap his ass off over minimal production? So we're definitely kind of getting the more, you know, I would say Lemon Pepper Freestyle is a little bit kind of in the R&B, kind of contemplative Drake vibe, but we definitely have a lot of the 40 production here on this project. Yeah, Drake really feels like rapping right now. I mean, I guess that's something that we have been able to see over the music he's released over the past few years. Dark Lake demo tapes definitely prioritize bars over big pop-leaning hits. He doubled really down on a similar strategy with Scary Hours 2, trying to probably prove himself a little bit to those rap fans who are always more skeptical like me and saying, oh yeah, he's a pop star. And of course, he released a song where he was rapping about how he was a pop star recently with DJ Khaled as well. Yeah, he says, I have to give people that like the singing enough to hold on, and I have to give LeBron enough bars, he told Rap Radar, which is very, very good to, it's kind of very, very true and a kind of a self-deprecating statement. You know, like, Drake, if he is one thing, he is definitely self-aware. Like, you cannot call the guy, like, not self-aware. Like, he knows exactly where his bread is buttered. He knows what people think of him. He's not delusional like that in any way. But yeah, it's interesting to see that kind of mindset take hold. And yeah, you kind of get the sense Drake is starting to really want to prove himself and give LeBron James some more bars on this project. And trust me when I say it's probably not just LeBron James either. Yeah, for years he talked about feeling pressure to please two different fan bases, and I think he's definitely got a point, and he's very good at covering all these bases. So really, Drake here, he sounds energized. He's flexing that range as a rapper. On What's Next, he plays around with an okay flow over production. That sounds something like Playboi Carti would wake up at 4 a.m. dreaming about. On Wants and Needs, he connects with another one of the hottest rappers on the planet, Lil Baby, for a song that's probably going to be sitting at the top of Rap Caviar for a bit. And on Lemon Pepper Freestyle, he gives one of those late-night talks he always mentions, delivering enough standout lines for Twitter to drool over whenever he whenever he decides to drop Certified Lover Boy. As one who said he studies rap battles for a living, Drake seems to be thinking about nothing but rap by now, based on the music he's chosen to release anyway. Maybe he's just saving it all up for all the R&B up for the Certified Lover Boy, but I'm sure there's going to be kind of a healthy mix on that project, which is said to be something a little bit more in terms of like a reasonable length, not like 25 songs or something crazy like the last album was. That was just way, way too much for me. But it is interesting to see, like, the best Drake duo, I think it still remains the best Drake duo out there right now, is him and Rick Ross. They stay consistent for more than a decade. They found a formula that they've been doing this since 2010. Aston Martin Music, Stay Scheming in 2012, and all the way to Gold Roses in 2019. Now they've added Lemon Pepper Freestyle to the collection, the two modern and the two, you know, earlier works that each time are really classics. They're great songs. Gold Roses, I think, is a really great song. Lemon Pepper Freestyle, I haven't really listened enough to fully process and, like, decide we're going to put it in the pantheon, but I would definitely say Gold Roses is a good song. It's a great song for, you know, winding down. It's not the best in that kind of genre, but just, again, like, nothing really Drake does is the best in the genre, but it's definitely very, very good, and he does things that can compete with so many other artists in so many different genres. So that's what makes Drake Drake. Drake still continues to be quite funny. Yeah, I mean, with a couple of lines and kind of a well-timed bite of an apple, Drake delivered a funny moment on the Super Bowl in a State Farm ad last month, and he continues his comedic streak on Scary Hours 2. With a little bit of humor in his bars. On Wants and Needs, he jokes, "The earrings are real, the petty is real, might charge my ex for a feature." Other times he's more subtly funny, like on What's Next, where he pokes fun at other artists who boosted their album sales with merch bundles, proudly declaring, "This one ain't coming with a bundle." A little bit of a shot at people like, you know, Nicki Minaj and Travis Scott, who had the big fights over the bundles and who's selling the most albums and all that stuff. Yeah, in some instances, it's all about the delivery. On Lemon Pepper Freestyle, he mentions people at parent-teacher conferences asking if he knows Beyonce and Nicki Minaj. And he pauses for an extra beat with perfect comedic timing. You know, Eddie Murphy would be proud. Dave Chappelle would be proud. And his with the, "Of course I do. Trust me, parents. Trust me." He's talking about, you know, how uncomfortable he is in the parent-teacher conferences in his, you know, wherever, Calabasas or wherever he lives. Yeah, and just so you know, he's been handling the challenges of the pandemics and the leaks that he's had to deal with very, very well. Yeah, so if it weren't for the pandemic, he would probably have already dropped, and also his recent knee injury, he probably would have already dropped his album by now. But given the circumstances, he's changed his plans and pushed the release date back a couple of times. Where the other artists have gone completely dark, though, Drake has adapted and figured out ways to constantly remain a focal point of the conversation. He's held this over, and he's done really pretty strong. He has not lost, like, relevance, or at least some sort of, like, he's always been in the periphery throughout 2020, throughout the course of the pandemic. He's always been in the periphery, doing something to, in some way, make the fans interested in what he has to say and what he's putting out there. That is for sure. It's very, very impressive, certainly. But, yeah, we have another instance of that. You know, we've seen it with, you know, the OVO Radio. Some SoundCloud Lucy's put together for Dark Lane demo tapes, a project that held fans over during album delays. It was also allowed him to monetize some of those kind of leaked songs in a very sneaky way, which is very clever of him, just getting some of those back into his control that, like, you know, SoundCloud leakers have put out there. And a lot of people don't go after the SoundCloud leaks. A lot of people, especially a lot of Drake fans, are not the people, like, trolling SoundCloud looking for, like, "Where's the Drake leak? Where's the Drake leak? I need a list of this kind of stuff." You know, they listen to it when they hear it on the radio, when they see it in Apple Music. You know, it is not that kind of game, I think, for a lot of, like, Drake fans. They're not obsessives, although there are definitely many, many of them out there. Yeah, so Drake also, he talks a lot about, you know, fatherhood and all these kind of big concepts, thinking about his mortality and all that stuff. It was very interesting to see the mind of someone absolutely at the top of their career, what they're going through. Yeah, so he said, he raps, "I sent her the child support. She sent me the heart emoji," which is kind of exactly how Drake, one would expect Drake to talk about paying child support. Then he rhymes, "Recess hits, daddy probably made another M." Before painting a humorous picture of wives googly-eyed at parent-teacher meetings asking if you know Beyonce or Nicki Minaj. And again, it's really interesting to, like, to actually get that perspective. You could see Drake. You'd see him sitting down there just, like, crossing his legs on one of those, like, school desks in, you know, Adonis' classroom, being like, "Oh, you know, hey, how you guys doing today? I'm Drake. You know, I know Nicki Minaj and Beyonce. Don't worry about it." Yeah, so Drake's Lemon Pepper flow verse is so strong, he gives several topics a good amount of bars. One of them is, jarringly, his funeral. Talking about wanting to die at the Air Canada Center. Said, "Y'all gonna have to fly in and do your fake cry. Artists go there sometimes," but then he keeps rhyming about the scene. "Imagine the first couple of rows, you gonna see the real guys, the ones that purchase their vehicles because of the trunk size. It's not the first time Drake has spoken about his mortality." And there's no huge takeaway from that set of bars, but it kind of, you know, was a little bit of a startle to be like, oh, yeah, well, you know, he's contemplative. He's been similar to that in the past, but it's definitely kind of a continuous trend of Drake kind of being this, you know, "When I die, well, I've really done what I wanted to do, kind of very, you know, I don't know the right word, but like, you know, introspective, you know, whatever the word you want to use there. Also, someone who's really kind of killed it on the features there, Lil Baby, really heating up, getting more texture, definitely getting a lot more depth to his rap. It's been really clear and very exciting to see. He followed up a solid Drake verse that was bogged down by an incongruous interaction with a synth loop there at the beginning and took the track to the stratosphere with a melodic double time flow. My first impression that this was the second best verse on the project. Lil Baby's words, on the rap that they definitely kind of fit the description there. He says, "I'm not a goat, but I fit the description." I mean, it really does. It's going to be, he's moving into that territory for sure. Definitely one of the kind of biggest power players out there in the rap game right now. Definitely developing kind of a distinctive style and a lot more listenable, a lot more like, textured, a lot more depth, a lot more like experimentation in the production, not just, you know, you know, I feel like I'm imitating that Snoop Dogg clip, but it's true. It's to a certain extent with Lil Baby, a lot of time, especially for the earlier music, it was true. It was a very flat and didn't have a lot of depth or texture to it at all. So yeah, Drake, obviously he can't help but sneak a few hints on about his social life and music, and they pop up throughout Scary Hours too on Lemon Pepper Freestyle. He mentions that How I Get a Girl and Girls Still Want to Holla on What's Next. He's explaining why he's taking some time away from the industry, suggesting his vacation was spent relaxing and possibly with somebody by his side, saying, "And on Valentine's Day, I had sex, okay?" Yeah, thank you. Thank you for telling us. You know, we know you had a good time on Valentine's Day. You're Drake. You know, every day is probably pretty cool for you. It may seem Drake is courting someone new these days. They're probably not that serious. He reminds us with the bars, "I love you to death, but I told you the truth. I can't just be with you and only you," he confesses on What's Next. It's nothing new for Drizzy to reflect on his romantic relationships on Wax, but the new hints are likely setting the groundwork for what's to come on Certified Lover Boy. A lot more kind of love talk. Drake and Kanye's complicated relationship goes back years, but it really hasn't always been pretty. Last year, Drake seemed to shade Ye on Life is Good, rapping, "Bleep, wanna gotta move off my release date, huh?" You know, that is a clear, just if you remember the Rap Radar podcast, he was very annoyed. And it was a Rap Radar podcast he was on talking about this, and also LeBron James Show, The Shop. Some fans also speculated whether Drake was talking about Kanye on Laugh Now, Cry Later when he rapped, "Distance between us is not like a store. This isn't a closable gap." It didn't sound like Drake had moved on from his beef with Ye. Definitely seems like Ye's got some pretty more important things on his mind right now with the divorce he's currently going through. But on Wants and Needs, Drake suggests that he's ready to meet up with Kanye, rapping, "Yeah, I should probably go link with Yeezy, but I need me some Jesus. But soon, as I started confessing my sins, he wouldn't believe us." This line comes off as a kind of a fun jab at Kanye, who's recently been kind of become a born-again Christian and dedicated a lot of his music career to his faith recently. But also many interpreted the bar to be a peace offering, finally. You know, like, it's kind of been a little bit one-sided. Kanye just hasn't really seemed to be bothered. It's funny and way less vicious than some of the previous disses that have come from Drizzy. Drizzy disses, I guess you could call them. Even Kanye might be satisfied with that mention. Still, it's clear that Drake and Kanye are still on each other's minds, and it'd be interesting to see, like, who would moderate the Drake-Kanye peace talks. Be interesting to see. But finally, all these rumors that could talk about, we always hear, just like Tom Brady, "Oh, Drake's falling off. He's not long for this world. He's kind of screwed." But no, he will continue to be around for, you know, as much as the haters hate it, deep into the future. All right, we are now going to shift gears and talk about how rappers have in pretty cool ways manifested things, kind of predicted things, and really ended up getting them to come to life in a really cool way. As the saying goes, speaking things into existence always holds weight. And if you don't believe that, hip-hop's biggest names can attest to it. Back in 2010 was when Tyler, the Creator, was flaring up as a kind of rising artist on the scene. The L.A.-bred rapper tweeted that he was going to win a Grammy one day. Just watch. One decade later, his fifth album, Igor, is the reason he won his very first Grammy for Best Rap Album at the 2020 awards show. Tyler's Manifestation Marker was a prestigious award, but for Juice WRLD, it was doing a collaborative project with one of his idol, Future. In 2017, Juice claimed that the joint project would be with the Atlanta rapper would be the day that he made it. And a year later, the pair tag team releasing WRLD on Drugs, and it does not get much more gratifying than that. Like, when you set up those standards, when you're like, yeah, I know that I made it, like, when I did this, and then a year later, you do that thing that you set up for yourself, it's a pretty cool feeling. You know, it is, you're setting standards by yourself, like your own standards of success, and then you're hitting those standards. Got to be a pretty cool feeling, especially when you're talking about doing a like collaborative album with one of the biggest stars in hip hop music as a hip hop artist. So yeah, that is pretty cool stuff. Here's another example of this. Wiz Khalifa, if tweeting out 2009, July 16th, 2009. If you're confused, I left Warner Bros. Rostam. Taylor Gang is the Revolution. I see great success in the future. This is, again, after he signed a seven-figure deal. He left Warner Brothers Records for a new home called Rostrum Records. Just like that, everything that followed, though, had at his new home in Taylor Records. Taylor Gang had a pretty much up arrow staple to it, like Diamond Records, Platinum Albums, and even roles on the big screen for Wiz. And kind of pretty successful career in the acting game, and continued to pretty much cement himself from that point. Even though he left that big Warner Brothers Records deal, it was a little bit intimidating. I'm sure it was very intimidating for him at the time. He was confident, and he really, I think it's pretty clear, managed to achieve some pretty high levels of success. Also, Roddy Ricch, this is back in 2016, This is pretty cool. When he was like still in the game, still working up, he tweeted, "I just reached 100K views. Could you give me feedback on my single? It's engineered by me at DJ Mustard hashtag Ask DJ Mustard." Just trying to get himself in there. Maybe DJ Mustard was like doing some sort of like giveaway, like I'm gonna give you some feedback on this or something like that. And Roddy Ricch, he took his opportunity and got some feedback, and probably doesn't really need it that much anymore. Whether we're talking about the heat on songs like Ballin' or High Fashion, Roddy Ricch and Mustard are building an unblemished track record. I'm pretty sure, they made Roddy Ricch was on Mustard's collaborative album. And they worked together for quite a bit of time. And a working relationship is one that Roddy has had clearly on his mind since 2016. Things like random tweets eventually worked, and their link up resulted in magic. Yeah, manifesting things, just doing things like all the interviews that I've ever had on the Spencer Walsh Radio Network. It's not because like I got some like big connections and I'm like working and networking everybody. No, it's just like I turn my Twitter post notifications on and try and get people to like respond to DMs and in like a very strategic way, asking them if they could come on the show. And normally people are nice enough to do it and respond to my emails and provide me with a guest, or in some cases they don't. But it definitely does not hurt to ask. And if you manifest things and if you push for things, it could really work. And you gotta be passionate, you gotta be confident, you gotta put yourself out there. And that is a great, this is a great reminder of that for sure. Big Sean, he wrote, "I wrote myself a $1 million check in fifth grade. I put it on the wall and promised it'd be this way." He wrote that 2015 when he was finally famous, or I guess you could say at that time. But kids have big dreams for claiming what they aspire to be when they grow up. Firefighters, basketball players, and doctors are just some of the professions youngsters may list off. But how about a millionaire? Big Sean remembers framing a fake $1 million check as a student in fifth grade. He certainly had big dreams for himself, and most of the time, a lot of people have big dreams. But, I mean, I would say more than any other rapper, really, Big Sean made so much of his, like, career and identity, like, about being famous and aspiring to be famous. And I think it's safe to say he is pretty famous at this point. As an adult, he can hang that fake one next to the real one, and probably many times over, he was secured as a multi-platinum Grammy Award-nominated rapper. This is pretty cool. Chance the Rapper, tweeted on September 29th, 2011, "Finna buy at J. Cole North Carolina album now. Hopefully he'll buy mine one day." And I'm pretty sure he probably ended up doing that. Chance the Rapper could only hope back in 2011 someone like J. Cole took the time to purchase his music. There's no confirmation that Cole did. I mean, but you have to assume, right? Like, just for the sake of the story sounding nice. But considering how the North Carolina rapper shouted at the Chicago Spitter a few years later for saving hip-hop, it's safe to assume Chance got the acknowledgement he asked for. So it really is quite a testament to, like, show how these rappers kind of come up. And you never know, right, which one is going to be the big new star, which one's going to kind of change the face of hip-hop and make it, like, revitalize the art form. But, you know, it could be just one random kid that you're kind of putting off or you're not so sure about. But it always feels good, of course, to discover the next big thing. And that is definitely what Chance seems, or Chance really was at the time. He was building himself up and hoping that J. Cole would even buy his album. But instead, he says that Chance the Rapper saved hip-hop. Pretty cool stuff. Yeah, so on Drake's 2007 comeback season cut, The Winner, he raps about taking time out of his early 20s to lock in on music and sleep instead of partying. It all paid off considering the successful decade to follow this 2009 tweet, where he wrote on April 13th, 2009, spending every moment in the studio. And boy, that's right, he was. Because it really all came back to help him, I think, in the end. Kendrick Lamar had a kind of interesting tweet like this. Everything changed when Dr. Dre revealed he wanted to work with Kendrick Lamar during an interview at a radio station in 2010. From there, from one Compton legend to another, the torch passing began. This is something that KDOT had been dreaming about since he was a child, and it was really, really, I would say, quite cool to see the collaboration pay off. This is the tweet that he wrote back in 2010. In the booth, trying to pull this last verse off, frustrated, phone on silent, 30 messages, Dr. Dre on the word radio, can't wait to work with me, ? And yeah, that was obviously when he had just kind of found out the news of the fact that, yeah, Dr. Dre was just on the radio in my hometown radio station, my hometown, like, most popular artist, like, the one who everyone knows, everyone loves, and is super, like, thrilled about, like, one broadly considered to be one of the most important artists in hip-hop. Like, yeah, he's like, oh, he wants to work with me. Okay. Yeah, that's kind of what the feeling must have been like for him at the time, and you can tell. Like, look where he went out from there. Yeah, so Jack Harlow has a tweet. He's our next kind of exhibit of this. And really, it is kind of crazy how rappers have kind of manifested things, made goals, set goals for themselves, and ended up reaching them. He wrote, about a year and a half ago, we went to Birmingham for the first date of the Gazebo tour. There was literally maybe 11 people in the building. I remember telling myself, if I could just travel the country and have decently packed shows every night, I'd be cool. I'd be content. This is 2019. And look where he is right now. Rubbing up with some of the biggest names in pop culture, whether it be basketball players, whether it be other rappers, and having some of the most successful songs on the radio. Yeah, if that doesn't convince you to manifest and sit down, what will? I mean, come on, right? It is pretty cool here. This is back in 2015. This is Cardi B celebrating. Yes, I made billboards, and I'm independent, going harder with I'm going harder with Gangsta Bitch Music Volume 2 with my fans, and God help. This is when she first celebrated. She got 42 likes back then when she had the Cardi B, when she had her mixtape first on the charts, Gangsta Bitch Music Volume 2. That was before Bodak Yellow for Cardi B. This is, again, since 2015. When she's been putting work towards her music career. That's when she joined Love & Hip Hop New York. And a year later, she dropped her first mixtape, Gangsta Bitch Volume 1, which was her first project to enter the Billboard charts. The 2016 tweet where she insists she's going harder for Volume 2 and her fans, with her fans and God's help, after just being named the first female rapper to achieve Diamond certification with Bodak Yellow. It's apparent she's definitely living up to those sentiments tenfold. All right, so yeah. You know, we got Travis Scott, Isaiah Rashad, and this is kind of a sad one from him. It's kind of incredible how he's turned out. If anyone from the Nashville Murfreesboro area knows of any job openings, let me know. Rap ain't paying the bills, guys. This was 2012. He's really wanted to do this for quite a long time. He put out a tweet in search of employment. Maybe he was discouraged then, but a year later in Chattanooga, Tennessee, he was signed to Top Dog Entertainment at Soul Music in the ensuing months that nowadays he barely even drops. So yeah, Isaiah Rashad, pretty cool story. I really liked kind of discovering his music, and especially his collaborations with Kendrick Lamar, including "What's Wrong," and some "For the Heavenly Father" is another kind of a great example of that. But he unfortunately hasn't dropped since 2016, though. So yeah, he made it, but don't really know what is up with him now. But it is a great example. You see all these like lists. Examples of rappers who really persevered and really gone on to do some pretty cool things. A great example of just for you that a lot of people, like these people coming from, like, obviously in some cases very, very poor backgrounds and bad economic situations where they didn't have all the resources, but I mean, through their own kind of like sheer power of will, they persevered. And it's a tough thing to do in today's society, that is for sure, especially if you're not a rapper. But yeah, credit to them, and may you as a person continue to do the same. So before we go today, do want to give you the song, my personal pick for song of the week. What I've been getting into recently is Childish Gambino. Yes, I'm getting back into him again. He has just a great, great example of just really cool sounding kind of alternative rap and hip-hop and different kind of interpretations of that. Whether you go back through his most recent album, I recommend you get songs like 1238, 2419 in there. Very, very kind of popular. Not entirely popular, but this kind of like, this one kind of fell under the radar with the pandemic and all that. This kind of came out March 15th, 2020. Literally almost a year ago, right as the pandemic was kind of kicking up. But a very cool, kind of creative album. Of course, you got Awaken My Love and The Red Bone. 2013's Because the Internet is another kind of classic one that really put him on the map. If you're looking for really talented guy, well put together music, creative, imaginative, and very, very cool sounding, especially one, my personal favorite, The Worst Guys, one that I've been listening to, Childish Gambino is the person for you this week. That's all we have. See you next week. It's on Culture.